Bam, it's true. In this video, we're going to take a look at simplifying square roots. Now, to do this process, we're going to have to work with two basic properties of working with radicals, even though this video is specific to square roots. And by the way, in this video, we're only going to be simplifying square roots that have numerical values underneath that radical sign, not algebraic examples. So just be aware of that, please. Multiplication property for when our a values and a and b values are greater than or equal to zero, because you can't square root a negative number, says that the square root of a times b is equal to the square root of a times the square root of b. Now, an example of that, here we have the square root of 4 times 9. Now, we can do that in our head. The square root of 4 is equal to 2, the square root of 9 is equal to 3, and 2 times 3 does equal 6. So, when we get done working out this example, we should have an answer of 6 when we use this property. And I'm actually working this property from right to left in this example. So, it says here, if I have the square root of two numbers and I would like to multiply those together, I can write one big radical sign and put the multiplication underneath the single radical. So that means that we're going to have that this is equal to the square root of 4 times 9, and 4 times 9 is 36, and the square root of 36 is equal to 6. And that is what we got in our head, remember? The square root of 4 is 2. Square root of 9 is 3. 2 times 3 is indeed equal to 6. So the property, at least in this example, is holding up. The division property as well is going to get used. And again, our a and b values have to be greater than or equal to 0 because you can't square root a negative number. That property says, again, basically we're just saying that we can give each factor inside this division its own square root symbol. So the square root of a divided by b is equal to the square root of a divided by the square root of b. And at least an example of that, let's do it in our head first without using the property, because I've come up with a very simple example. It's 36 divided by 4. 36 divided by 4 is equal to 9, and the square root of 9 is equal to 3. So we should get a 3 at the end of this problem. Using the property where I have a fraction underneath the square root symbol, radical, I can give each factor, the numerator and the denominator, their own square root symbol. So we're going to have this is equal to the square root of 36 over the square root of 4. The square root of 36 is equal to 6. The square root of 4 is equal to 2. And 6 divided by 2 is indeed equal to 3, the same answer that we just got a second ago, when we just sort of did this easy problem in our head, relatively easy problem. Now, that's not what this video is about. We're just going to be using these properties again. What we're going to be doing is simplifying square roots, and there's a few steps here. The second one is optional, but definitely a good idea when you first start learning how to do this process of simplifying these square roots. Factor the value, the number that's underneath your square root symbol, within the square root, so that one factor is a perfect square. Now, when I say perfect square, I'm talking about 2 squared, 3 squared, 4 squared. 2 squared is 4. 3 squared is 9. 4 squared is 16. And 25, and 36, and 49. Those are your perfect squares. Any number like 8 squared is 64. 64 is a perfect square because you can square root it and get a whole number answer. Square root of 64 is equal to 8. Separate those factors, giving each one their own square root symbol, and then simplify. Those values, those perfect squares that are underneath the square root symbols, are going to get simplified into whole number answers, and thus you'll have your final solution. Enough of me talking, though. Let's look at some examples. So we're going to do 5 examples total. This is the first 4. The square root of 32. Well, step 1 says factor the number within the square root so that one of those factors is a perfect square. Well, we got a lot of perfect squares that are in 32. One possible set of examples or factors would be the square root of 4 times the square root of 8. But if you can do it so that you can find the largest possible perfect square that goes in there, that would be better. And if you're just learning how to do this, you might want to be reminded or give yourself a reminder list of what those perfect squares are. So let's just do a little column over here. I'll write PF for perfect squares. And perfect squares, again, are your 1 squared, which is 1. But multiplying by 1 doesn't do anything, so forget that. 2 squared is 4. 3 squared is 9. 3 times 3 is 9. 4 squared, 4 times 4 is 16. And then 5 squared, 6 squared, 7 squared, 8 squared, 9 squared, and so on. You know, give yourself a list of these perfect squares to use while you start learning this process of simplifying these perfect squares. The biggest one within this list that will go into 32 is 16. And it's not a bad idea, not that it's totally necessary, but it's not a bad idea to write your perfect squares on the left side of your expression. So 32 is going to be the square root of 16 times the square root of 2. I guess maybe if I'm going to follow my directions to the T and get you using those properties I just mentioned, it's 16 times 2. Then you pull it apart if you need to, just to really emphasize that multiplication property, and have the square root of 16 times the square root of 2, and the square root of 16, the one that is a perfect square, is equal to 4. And that is the simplified version of the square root of 32. We don't want that run-on decimal, rounded-off decimal that we get from our calculator. This would also be identified as, you know, we're going to take the square root of 32, we're going to simplify it and keep it in exact form. That means if you take the square root of 32 in your calculator, you're going to get some kind of run-on decimal. It'll be 5 point something. And that decimal really goes on forever. It's an irrational number. That means the decimal never repeats and never ends. So no matter what decimal version you write down, it has some bit of round-off error. This has no round-off error, and thus it is an exact form. The square root of 15. Well, the square root of 15, it only has, well, besides 1 and 15, it has two, okay, so it has two pairs of factors. 1 and 15, and 3 and 15. Oops, excuse me, 3 and 5. Well, 3 is not a perfect square. 3 squared is 9, but 3 is not a perfect square. You cannot square root 3 and get a whole number answer, nor can you square root 5 and get a whole number answer. So, you know, to simplify the square root of 15, the simplified version of square root of 15 is the square root of 15. I can't make the number underneath that square root symbol any smaller. 3 square root of 24. What perfect square goes into 24? 1 and 24, 2 and 12, 3 and 8. How about 4 and 6? 4 is a perfect square. So this can be rewritten as 3 times the square root of 4 times 6. We're going to give each one of those factors with a multiplication property their own square root symbol. The square root of 4 is equal to 2. And notice that I've written 3 times 2. I mean, this leading coefficient is touching the square root symbol, which indicates multiplication. So I need to then put in a little dot or put in parentheses to indicate that I still need to do that multiplication. And 3 times 2 is equal to 6. And for the last example I had room for, which was 3 square root of 2 squared, that anytime you square something, you're multiplying it by itself. So 3 square root of 2 squared is 3 square root of 2 times 3 square root of 2. This is all straight multiplication, so The parentheses are just highlighting that I'm writing that base twice. They're not really doing much more in this particular problem. And we're going to put the 3's together. We're going to put the square roots together. Or I should say we're going to put the leading coefficients together. So 3 times 3 is equal to 9. The square root of 2 times the square root of 2 is the square root of 4. The square root of 4 is equal to 2, so I'm going to go ahead and simplify that. And 9 times 2 is equal to 18. I'm showing a lot of steps because I'm trying to, of course, you know, teach you how to do the process. If you're first learning the simplification concept of square roots, you do really want to show all of those steps on those easier questions that you can do in your, even if you can do them in your head, because then when you get into the problems that have algebraic variables or just simply numbers too big for you to easily do in your head, you'll have practiced that this process so that when you get to the harder ones, you can't just glance at and go, that's the answer. You'll know how to do those harder problems. You want to reinforce those steps so you have memorized for later. I got one more example and then we'll be done. We got to at least do one example that has the quotient rule in it. We have the square root of 75 over 16. So we're going to give the numerator and denominator their own radical, their own square root symbol. The bottom is square root of 16. That is a perfect square because 4 times 4 is equal to 16. So the square root of 16 is going to be 4. And the square root of 75, well, the square root of 75, it ends with a 5, so it's divisible by 5. And we have 25, which is a perfect square in here. Let's see. 75 divided by 25 is equal to 3. 3 quarters, right, is 75 cents. So this is going to be the square root of 25 times the square root of 3. You do, again, want to keep those perfect squares first, just to make it a little bit neater in your work. The square root of 25 is equal to 5. So we have 5 square root of 3 over 4, or because you can pull this apart and have the square root of 3 over 1, you could also rewrite that as you saw me start to do as 5/4 square root of 3. And that is the end of my video of simplifying numerical values underneath a square root symbol. I'm Mr. Tarrou. Bam! Go do your homework.